So, Archie Frazer Nash, he was born in India because his family were out there working. And when he came back to England as a young boy, and when he left college, he started putting cars together with his good friend, Ron Godfrey. These cars are called GNs, which is G for Godfrey, his friend, and N for Nash, Archie Frazer Nash. They loved moving vehicles, and they decided to make their own vehicle, and this is the first thing they came up with. This wooden chassis with a very primitive motorcycle engine, the whole thing driven by rubber belts. When he came out of college, they started going into production of these cars. They were known as cycle cars because of the motorcycle engine, and they proved to be very popular. There were various other ones made by Morgan, for instance, and other manufacturers. They were cheap and cheerful, and that's what people could afford at the time. Archie was an excellent engineer, an excellent racing driver, and a very outgoing and a friendly person, but he wasn't much of a businessman. Eventually lost control of his company, and this is where the Aldingtons come into the picture. H.J. Aldington had worked for Archie, first of all as an apprentice at GN, and then later on as a sales manager, in fact the key salesman for Archie. So he was what Archie was not. He was the salesman, he was the businessman. He was also a very good racing driver and something of an engineer, but not to the extent that Archie was. So what happened was there was a little bit of politics going on, and with the financiers involved, they moved Archie aside and they moved H.J. Aldington in, and he took over the company. And that's where we get to the next side of the story of Frazer Nash.
Well, I had bought my first Nash in about 1963, I think. It took me about 10 years to rebuild it. Of course, it was a lot of money, it was £100. But I paid it in installments, and after about a year I'd actually purchased it. And then I saw the light, really, and got a proper car. I got a GM, you see. It's much better. These things are wonderful. They're much better than all this post-war rubbish, but the GN is a man's car. These are ladies' cars. This is 1934 TT replica. It was originally fitted with the Meadows, but very rapidly, I think within a year, was fitted with a six-cylinder Blackburn engine. I took it to the Dolomites in 2009 on a Frazer Nash raid, and a wonderful time. It has a specially adapted, I think it's self-adapted, silencing system whereby you take it up to about 4,000 RPM and take your foot off the throttle. There's a sort of bang like that from the silencer. And we find this extremely useful when being pursued by a German motorcyclist. We'd wait till we got in a tunnel with three of them behind you and take your foot off the thing, and they'd all fall off their motorbikes. It was wonderful, yes. Lovely car.
We're very lucky to have this car. It's quite famous. It's one of the Le Mans replicas. They made 34 Le Mans replicas altogether, and nearly all of them were raced at circuits by famous drivers. This particular one was raced by the famous Stirling Moss, now known as Sir Stirling Moss, and he raced it twice in 1951 and 1952 in the Isle of Man in the British Empire Trophy race, and he was the overall winner in 1951. So this is probably one of the most valuable Frazer Nashes in existence today. Where H.J. was very successful was in the Alpine trials of the 1930s, 32, 33 and 34. He and his customers competed very successfully in the Alps, the Dolomites, in the Frazer Nashes. But eventually, in 1934, they were beaten by the brand new BMWs. BMW had only recently come into the market for making cars. It's not the big company it is today. It was an aero engine company. And in fact, they started by making Austin 7s under license. But by the mid-30s, they had a good sports car and they beat the Frazer Nash. H.J. Aldington was so impressed by these new BMWs that he got in touch with the Germans and said, why don't you let me be your agent in England? And in fact, I'd like to build your cars in England. He didn't, in fact, ever end up building them because the Second World War got in the way, but he did import thousands of BMWs into England, and They were badge engineered in that they had, they were called Frazer Nash BMWs, and they were right-hand drive, but they were actually built in Germany and imported into England. So the BMW relationship was a very successful one for both parties. It was a major market outside of Germany for BMW. And then, of course, we had the Second World War, and that brought it all to a grinding halt. BMW was, in essence, not a car company, but an aero engine company, and produced very serious engines for the Luftwaffe, etc. And, of course, therefore, they attracted a lot of bombing from the Allies. And eventually, their factories were pretty much annihilated. And that was almost the end of BMW right there.
H.J. Aldington and his older brother Bill visited Munich in 1945 to see the state of affairs there and meet their friends and business partners at BMW. And what they found was utter devastation. They were given loads of drawings, all the drawings that had survived the war. And in some ways, most importantly, this car, which is a BMW 328 chassis and engine with a special lightweight streamlined body. It competed in the 1940 Millimiglia, and again they did very, very well there, and HJ was able to bring one of these home pretending it was his own personal car, and that proved to be the basis for the new post-war Frazer Nash.
He even brought in Fritz Fiedler, who was the designer of BMWs before the war, and he came over for a few years and helped establish these new cars.
He had a very kindly nature, apparently, and this meant that the English workers, who just fought a war against Germany again, nonetheless accepted this man because he was a very good individual.
So they were very successful for a few years with these new Frazer Nashes. They were slightly improved BMWs from the late 30s, but they were very successful through the early 50s with many racing drivers like Stirling Moss, Tony Brooks, Roy Salvadori, Mike Hawthorne. All of them raced Frazer Nashes, and they were very successful up until about the mid-50s, when cars like the Lotus and Listers and various other lighter purpose-built racing cars proved more successful and took over from the Frazer Nashes. And therefore, Frazer Nash really came to an end soon after that. Their last car they built was in 1957, but really they'd ceased to produce in any numbers by 1954-55. Post-war, they only ever produced about 12 cars a year, only about one car a month. They were very good in their day, but that was the end. They then moved on to, they did a relationship, just like they had with BMW, with Porsche. And so the Frazer Nash company then became the major, or the importer of Porsches into England. And that really brings the story to an end.
So, I first came across Frazer Nash as a car maker about 7 or 8 years ago, when I was lucky enough to be able to indulge my passion for old cars, and I decided that now then would have been a good time to go shopping and buy an old car to do something in. So I had in mind initially, I considered E-Type Jaguars, Aston Martins, Austin Healey's, all the sort of classic English, and in my mind, whatever car I bought had to be English. So I considered all of these slightly more ubiquitous English makes. But then just happened by chance one afternoon, whilst wandering around the rather smart Mews garages of South Kensington, to come across the Targa Florio sitting in the window of one of these garages. And I was taken by how beautiful it was, and so I foolishly walked in and started talking to the nice chap whose garage it was as to what the car was and how it worked and what made it different. And only at the end of that conversation did I ask him how much it would cost, and I almost fell off my chair. It's, at the time, I can't remember what an E-Type would have been, but I would safely say it was 10 times the cost of an E-Type Jag. Anyway, not deterred by this, I ended up buying one, and then realised that the charm of having something which is so unique, that there are tens of thousands of E-Type Jaguars, there are a few thousand Aston Martins, but there are only almost single digits of Frazer Nash Targa Florios. I think there are 12 or 13. So having such an unusual car was really an attraction to me. It was different. It was enjoyable to drive. It's not flashy in any way. I didn't like the idea of having a car that would have been thought of as flashy. But it has a story. Starting to get addicted to the whole Frazer Nash mark, and shortly after buying them my second Frazer Nash, I then realised, well, what I really needed was a chain drive car to complete the family. So that's when I then started to look for and eventually found the chain drive car. Not many of those are for sale. They appear to be hung on to very tightly by the families that own them. So I'm very lucky to have got the one that I have got now. The unusual thing about these pre-war Frazer Nashes is that none of them have gearboxes. They are all driven by chain. You have four sets of cogs and chains which are permanently connected to each other. And when you change gear with the lever, you are deciding which set of chains and cogs to engage to the engine. So the largest one is first gear, the smallest one is fourth gear. And you're deciding which one to engage according to where you put the gear lever. It's a very compact and a very exciting car to be a part of, although you wouldn't necessarily want to use it for doing many miles of cruising. So the Le Mans rep is the car that I use most of all on the racetracks. It's taken me a long time to start to get to grips with it because it's quite a fussy car to drive. It's very narrow track to the wheels, the front wheels are very close together, the back wheels are very close together, makes it quite skittish on the circuit, and you need to be quite committed. But it's great fun driving on the circuit. It has a little engine, it's just under 2 litres, but it's got 6 cylinders, which is quite unusual. When it was a new car, it would probably have been producing about 125, 130 horsepower. Nowadays, with modern materials and modern knowledge, but nothing else, so not changing the design or the capacity of the engine, just using all of the modern innovations that have come since the war, we're getting about 170, 175 horsepower out of it, so a lot more powerful than it would have been in period. Top speed of that car is probably in the region of 120, and it's pretty light, so it accelerates quite briskly. It does have room for two people, although in period they were also used in single-seater races. The unique thing about KCD is that it is a fantastic entry ticket to most of the really exciting historic races around the world. So Monaco, I mentioned, the Classic Le Mans, the Goodwood Revival, the Silverstone Classic, all these big annual events, this car is invited to most of them, and it's always easy to get an entry with that car. My particular car has had an interesting life. At one point, it was used as a milk float, and another point in its life, it was used as a police car. Those were when it was brand new. It was delivered to its first owner in Kenya, and whilst it was in Kenya, it was used for short sprints and hill climbs. But also, the same chap used it for delivering milk and for going around his area as a policeman. Since then, it lived for a while in South Africa before I think it returned to the UK in the 80s. And three or four people have owned it since. It has been raced two of the historic Monaco Grand Prix. It's been raced by Stirling Moss, so that's its little claim to fame. And otherwise, it's now here with me back at home in Sussex, and it'll be used for going down to the pub on New Year's Day and other less strenuous duties.
Thank you. several different models here racing today at Castle Coombe, with two chain drive cars and one saloon car. Yeah, we're all very fortunate to be here having fun. Freddie Wakeman's put this car on the front row in the pre-war race, so hopefully we're looking for a race win. And I think Martin Hunt is the first of the post-war nationals in the fifth car race. So looking forward to a good fun race and a good day.
Hi, my name is Paul Baker. I've got a Frazer Nash Super Sports behind me, which I've had now for about 11 years. And I've got a six-cylinder AC engine, which goes very nice in the car. The engine actually weighs the same as the Meadows that you see in the other Frazer Nashes, despite being six cylinders and another 500cc. I've been racing the car, I say, for about 10, 11 years. And besides racing, also use it for the events laid on by the Frazer Nash Car Club. We go for rallies each year to different parts of the world. So this car has been to France, it's been to Sicily, it's been to Northeast Italy, Bolzano. And it's just a great road car as well as a brilliant track car as well.
The Frazer Nash Car Club is the best car club in the world, we say. I'm sure every other car club says the same, but in our case it's true. And the cars are quite rare. They only made a few hundred pre-war and less than 100 post-wars. So they're rare, they're interesting, they're very special.
Well, I think the word special comes to mind. They are completely different. And Archie Frazer Nash was a very jovial chap, enjoyed life throughout his life, and I always think that cars, particularly at a period when cars were made and designed by one man, the character of the man was reflected in the car itself and its performance.
Mm-hmm.